Plant morphology is the description of the physical form and external structure of plants, while plant anatomy is the study of the internal structure of plants. Look at this tomato plant. It is made up of roots, stems, leaves, flowers, and fruits. If you dig in deeper, you notice that the root is a taproot system, that the leaves are compound leaves and an alternate attachment to the stem. The flower parts are in multiples of fives, and the fruit is a fleshy berry. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and in this video, you will dive into the terms for plant anatomy and morphology so that you may understand plants more and be able to classify them. You'll also learn what I meant when I described that tomato plant. The plant's life cycle has three phases with varying characteristics. In the initial period of growth, the apical meristem, which is the primary growing point of the stem, will not typically respond to internal or external conditions to initiate flowers. The juvenile phase of development exhibits exponential increases in size and the inability to shift from vegetative to reproductive maturity, leading to the formation of flowers. In addition, juvenile plants have specific morphological and physiological traits. Hedera helix, or ivy, in the immature stage has five lobes, whereas in the mature stage, it has none. The ivy commonly seen around campuses is mostly immature. It is actually fairly hard to find plants in the mature stage. Young growth of Juniperus virginiana, eastern red cedar, has thorns, whereas older growth does not. Examples of physiological traits during the juvenile stage include vigorous plant growth, disease resistance, and a greater ability to regenerate roots and shoots. The reproductive or mature phase refers to qualitative changes that allow the plant or organ to express its full reproductive potential. Both genetic and environmental conditions determine when plants enter this phase. Senescence phase involves internally controlled deteriorative changes, which are natural causes of death. Changes that occur during senescence include the following: decreases in chlorophyll, protein, DNA and RNA, and photosynthesis, and changes in plant hormones, some increase while some decrease. When the senescence phase is complete, leaf abscission occurs. The leaves, stems, and roots make up the primary vegetative structures of the plant. They take part in growth processes that are essential to the plant's survival. The main function of a leaf is to manufacture food for the plant during photosynthesis. Photosynthesis refers to a series of chemical reactions in which carbon dioxide and water are converted in the presence of light and carbohydrates, sugar, and oxygen. Both light and chlorophyll are essential to photosynthesis. Carbon dioxide and other gases enter and exit the leaf through tiny pores in the leaf surface called stomata. Another important function carried out by the leaf is transpiration, which is the loss of water from the leaf in the form of water vapor. Respiration is another important function carried out by the leaf. This process uses sugars made during photosynthesis and breaks them down into simpler molecules such as water and carbon dioxide that are used as energy for plant growth and development. Leaves consist of several basic parts that help identify them. The major parts of a simple dicot leaf are listed here. If you start at the stem, the leaf stem or stalk that attaches the leaf is the petiole. The blade is the flat, thin part of the leaf. The midrib is the largest vein located in the middle of the leaf. Veins are used to transport water and nutrients throughout the plant. The different leaf venation patterns found in plants can be parallel, pennate, or palmate. Monocot plants have only parallel venation. The leaf margin is the outer edge of the leaf blade, which can be lobed, smooth, toothed, or various combinations of the three. The leaf apex is the tip of the leaf blade, which can be pointed, rounded, or a variety of other shapes. The leaf base is the bottom of the leaf blade, which can be rounded, pointed, or a variety of other shapes. A stipule is a small leaf-like appendage to a leaf, typically borne in pairs at the base of the leaf stalk. Various leaf coverings include hairy versus not hairy, waxy versus not waxy, and others. The simple leaf consists of one blade per petiole, such as found on an oak leaf. The compound leaf has two or more leaflets, such as found on a potato leaf. The main difference between a leaf and a leaflet is the position of the axillary bud, which is located at the base of the entire leaf. Leaflets do not have axillary buds. Differences in how leaves are attached to stems are commonly used as a means of plant identification. Leaves are attached to stems in three major patterns. The opposite pattern occurs when two leaves are directly across from each other, or two leaves per node. The alternate pattern occurs when leaves are staggered along the length of the stem, or one leaf per node. The whorled pattern occurs when three or more leaves are attached per node. Modified leaves are commonly mistaken for other structures such as flowers or stems. To illustrate this point, these are some examples of modified leaves. Bracts are leaves located just below the flower, for example, the poinsettia and dogwood. Tendrils are appendages produced by certain vines that wrap around a support and allow them to climb, for example, the grape. Stems can be used to identify plants with some practice. The stem has several important functions. Stems are used to support leaves, flowers, and fruits. Stems contain important transport systems, including the xylem for transporting water and minerals, and the phloem for transporting manufactured food. Stems can be used to manufacture food, but to a lesser extent than the leaves. Stems can act as a storage organ for food. An example of this is the Irish potato. The basic parts of the stem are described here. The terminal bud is positioned at the tip of the stem and contains an undeveloped leaf, stem, flower, or mixture of them all. The bud scale is a tiny leaf-like structure that covers the bud and protects it. The terminal bud scale scar is left when the terminal bud begins growth in the spring. It represents 1 year's growth. The axillary bud is located along the side of the stem below the terminal bud. The node is the point along the length of the stem where leaves or stems are attached. The internodal region is located between the nodes. The leaf scar is left when the leaf drops. The lenticels are tiny pores located in the stem and are used for gas exchange. An example of a tree with conspicuous lenticels is the cherry tree. Within the stem, the water, nutrients, and food made during photosynthesis are transported throughout the plant and stored for later use. The internal anatomies of a monocot has one cotyledon and parallel leaf venation, and dicot stem has two cotyledons and reticulate leaf venation are shown on the slide. A key feature is that monocots have vascular bundles that are scattered and dicots have vascular bundles in a ring. The following are key anatomical features found in stems. The outer layer of plant parts is the epidermis. Just like our skin is our epidermis. The primary tissue of the stem or root is the cortex, which is located between the epidermis and vascular region. Think of this as filler tissue. The cambium is the area where new plant cells are formed, either xylem or phloem during secondary growth. When grafting, the cambium layers must match for the graft union to be successful. The cambium is only found in woody plants. The xylem is composed of tiny tubes that transport water and nutrients up from the roots to other parts of the plant. The annual rings in a tree are made up of xylem. The phloem is composed of tiny tubes that transport manufactured food and carbohydrates from the leaves down to other parts of the plant, such as the roots and shoots. The pith is located in the center portion of the stem where food and moisture are stored. In addition to standard stems, there are also modified stems used for storage of reserves and for reproduction. An above-ground horizontal stem with long and thin internodes is a stolon, such as in strawberry runners. A below-ground horizontal stem is a rhizome, such as ginger root or turmeric. A tuber is an underground rounded swelling of a stem such as Irish potatoes. Corms are vertical thick stems with thin papery leaves like gladiolus. Bulbs are short shoots with thick fleshy leaves like onions and tulips. The major function of the root is to absorb water and nutrients to sustain plant life. In addition, roots act as storage organs for carbohydrates and provide anchor and support for the top portion of the plant. The first structure to emerge from a germinating seed is the root. The key parts of the root are described here. The primary root is the main root that first emerges from the seed, starting from the tip of the primary roots. There is a root cap Just behind the root cap is the area of cell division, followed by the area of cell elongation, and then the area of maturation or cell differentiation. The secondary root arises from the primary root. Root hairs are single cells that absorb the greatest amount of water and minerals. Improper handling during transplanting can cause the loss of many root hairs, which decreases the plant's water uptake and results in transplant shock. The root cap is located at the tip of the root and consists of several layers of cells that protect the root as it grows through the soil. There are two major classes of root systems. The taproot system has a primary root that grows down from the stem with only a few secondary roots. Both carrots and dandelions are examples. This is common for dicots. The fibrous root system has a large number of small primary and secondary roots. Potato plants and grasses are examples. This root system is common for monocots. Modified roots serve as a reserve food storage system. An example of a modified root is a sweet potato. Be careful not to confuse the modified root sweet potato with the modified stem Irish potato. The reproductive parts of the plant are the flowers, which are pollinated and fertilized to produce the fruits. The main function of the flowers is to attract pollinators and to produce fruit and seed. Flowers come in a variety of sizes, shapes, and colors to achieve their main function. In addition to their main function, flowers are commonly used for plant identification and produced commercially for their beauty and fragrance. A typical flower consists of four major parts. The sepals are green leaf-like structures located beneath the petals. The calyx is the term used to describe all the sepals on one flower. The calyx is used for protection. For example, some plants have calyx that contain spines, which deter animals from feeding on them. The petals are brightly colored portions of the flower that are used to attract pollinators. The stamens are the male reproductive part of the flower. The stamen consists of a filament that protects the anther, which produces the male sex cells, pollen. The pistils are the female reproductive part of the flower. The pistil consists of the stigma, which is the sticky surface for collecting pollen, the style, which is the tube that connects the stigma and ovary, and the ovary, which contains ovules or eggs. Monocots typically have flower parts in multiples of three, while dicots have flower parts in multiples of fours and fives. Flowers can be broken down into four different classes. The complete flower contains all four major flower parts: sepals, petals, stamens, and pistils. The incomplete flower lacks one or more of the major flower parts. In the photo of the American elm, the sepals and petals are lacking. Since these plants are pollinated through wind, this allows the wind to pick up the pollen easier and for it to blow onto the pistil. The perfect flower contains both stamens and pistils. The imperfect flower lacks either stamens or pistils. An example of a plant containing this type of flower is corn. Fruits are formed after the flower has been pollinated and fertilized. The definition of a fruit is a mature ovary of a flowering plant. There are two types of fruits. The fleshy fruit, such as a tomato, has soft fleshy material with or without seeds enclosed. The dry fruit, such as a sunflower, has seeds enclosed in a hard fruit wall. Isn't it wild that something like beans or corn is considered a fruit? From the botanical definition, a fruit simply comes from the ovary of a plant, while a vegetable comes from the roots, stems, leaves, or flowers of a plant, like cauliflower or lettuce. By this definition, a tomato is most definitely a fruit. The informal definition of fruit is something that is sweet. A seed is the mature fertilized egg that is contained in the fruit. Seeds can be dispersed by the wind like dandelions stuck to the fur of animals or spread in other ways. Dicots store their reserve food in cotyledons, whereas monocots store their food in the endosperm. The germination process is a series of events whereby the seed embryo goes from a dormant state to an actively growing state. For seed germination to occur, the following criteria must be met. The seed must be viable, which means that the embryo is alive and capable of germination. The seed must be exposed to appropriate environmental conditions. Primary dormancy must be overcome in the seed. Three stages of seedling germination are as follows. First is imbibition of water, which is the active uptake of water by the seed. After the seed is hydrated, pre-existing enzymes are immediately available for breaking down storage reserves, and new enzymes are produced for the breakdown of additional reserves. Lastly, pre-existing and newly formed enzymes break down food reserves, which are used for the germination process. The first visible sign of seed germination and growth is the emergence of the radical, followed by growth of the seedling. The following are two common forms of seed germination. Epigeous seed germination, where the hypocotyl elongates and brings the cotyledons above ground, like in cherries. Hypogeous seed germination, where the epicotyl emerges and the cotyledons remain below the soil surface, such as in corn. You heard various differences between monocots and dicots. You should be able to identify these differences. Here's a summary. Monocots have one cotyledon, leaf veins that are parallel, vascular bundles in their stem that are scattered, fibrous root systems, and flower parts in multiples of three. Dicots have two cotyledons, veins that are net-like or reticulate, vascular bundles are usually arranged in a ring, a taproot system, and flower parts in multiples of four or five. In conclusion, knowledge of basic plant anatomy, including vegetative, leaves, stems, and roots, and reproductive, flowers and fruits, plant parts, together with understanding the plant's life cycle is important in plant classification, as well as in maximizing the plant's potential uses.